You must have seen this setting in your house. You press the switch and the bulb starts glowing. Have you ever thought about what happens behind the wall that causes the bulb to glow? You must have heard from elders in your house or teachers in school that the glowing of a bulb is based on electric current. But what is electric current? Where it is made from? And how does this help in glowing the bulb? In today's video, we'll get to know what the electric current is and how it flows from one place to another. You must have seen a moving car. Some cars move fast and some slow. We also say that the car is moving at a speed of 40 km per hour. But what is this 40 km per hour? Meaning the car is covering a distance of 40 km in 1 hour. So when we compare anything with time, they are called the rate of that thing. Like the speed of the car, we can see the flow of water in the river in the same way and say that the water current is more. Similarly, the case with the air current as well. So it would be fair to say that current is a physical quantity which shows a relation of different parameters with time. If everything that flows has current, what will they call the current that glows the bulb when you put on the switch? We call it electric current. The rate of flow of electric charge is called electric current. If Q is the electric charge passing through a particular area in time t, then the ratio of Q and t represents electric current, which can be represented as I. The SI unit of electric current is ampere, whose symbol is A. The electric charge flows from one point to another through metallic wires. In the circuits having metallic wires, electrons create the flow of charge. The circuit should be closed from one end to another to let the charge flow. This closed path is called an electric circuit. This diagram shows a circuit in which the positive terminal of the battery is connected to the positive terminal of the bulb via wires through a switch, and the negative terminal of the battery is connected to the negative terminal of the bulb. Great, we understood the circuit. But what does this positive and negative mean? These positive and negative signs indicate the direction of current in the circuit. The electric current starts flowing from the positive terminal of the battery and ends at the negative terminal. It is also to be noted that electrons move in the opposite direction of the current. But we also know that electrons are responsible for the flow of charge and the electric current depends on the charge. Then why the electric current moves in the opposite direction? Due to the flow of electrons, a positive charge is generated in the metallic wires. The direction of this charge, which appeared to be in the opposite direction of the electrons, here the direction of the electric current is taken towards the direction of this positive charge, which is formed for no other reason but due to the flow of electrons. Just as the speedometer is used to measure the speed of the vehicle, similarly in any circuit, an instrument named ammeter is used to measure the electric current. Do you know a similar type of circuit is present in our homes too? But here, the positive and the negative wires are not connected to the battery, but are connected to the power supply coming into the house. We'll know more closely about this in the upcoming videos. The rate of flow of charge in a conductor is called electric current. This is the electric current that lights the bulb. We know that charge is always present in the metallic wires. So why do we need to put batteries in the circuit for the bulb to glow? Why is it necessary to put the battery? In the process of the lighting of the bulb, another physical quantity works along with the electric current, which is called electric potential difference. What is this electric potential difference? Let us try to understand this with the help of this example. Have you ever poured water on horizontal leveled floors and on slopes? Does water flows the same way in both the cases? The answer is no. On the slopes, the water flows till it reaches the bottom, and on the horizontal floor, it will stop flowing after a while. In the case of slopes, no extra force is required, whereas despite applying force on the horizontal floor, water stops flowing as soon as the effect of that force tends to zero. So, what is the difference between these two circumstances? Yes, you get it right. Height. Due to the difference in height, gravity and water molecules force each other on the slopes, due to which the water flows till the lowest point possible. What will happen if in the place of a horizontal floor, a water pipe is taken? What do you think, that we get the water by this pipe simply when we opened it up? No, we can't get any water until there is a force from behind or there is a pressure. To create this pressure, the water pipe should be connected to a water tank. As there is plenty of water in the tank, there will be more pressure in the mouth of the pipe. And as soon as we open the tap, if the pressure is low, the water starts flowing from the area having high pressure to the area having low pressure. Here too, like the slope, difference in pressure is obtained due to difference in height. So, we can conclude that to let the water flow, we need a pressure difference. If the water pipe is replaced by metallic wire and a water tank is replaced by a battery, then we get something like this. We know that the circuit must be closed for the current to flow. Let's attach the other terminal of the battery to the bulb.
Electricity is also like this tank's example.
To let the electric current flow, we need a difference in the circuit, like there was a pressure difference in the analogy of water tank example. This difference in the circuit is known as potential difference. Just as the water flow from high pressure to low pressure area, similarly, electric current also moves from high potential area to low potential area. The difference of voltage between one terminal of the battery and the other terminal is called potential difference. We get a potential difference due to various chemical reactions of the battery. In science, the work done in moving a unit charge from one place to another in the circuit is called potential difference. The difference is represented by the symbol of V and its SI unit is volt. A volt is the ratio of a joule and a coulomb. The potential difference is measured with the help of a device called a voltmeter. The voltmeter is always placed in parallel or parallel order. Various kinds of batteries having variation in potential difference are available in the market. In the upcoming videos, we'll get to know about the rules related to potential difference. As we have dealt with the two very important quantities related to electricity, electric current and potential difference, these two quantities form the foundation of electricity in physics. Now the question is, do these two functions work separately or is there a relationship between them? The definition says that the two quantities are individually different. But a German physicist named George Ohm learned from his experiment that there is a relation between electric current and potential difference. Ohm states that if physical conditions such as temperature, length, etc. are constant, then in an electric circuit, the electric current flowing in a metallic wire is directly proportional to the potential difference applied across its ends. So the question arises, in what ratio electric current increases and decreases then? Ohm named this ratio as resistance. But what is this resistance? Do you remember that water tank analogy from the last video? Here we use that analogy to understand this concept. If a valve is placed in a pipeline which controls the amount of water flowing towards the tap, then this valve acts as a resistance in the pipeline. Resistance literally means resisting anything. Here the one which resists is known as resistor. Here this valve resists water and controls its flow.
If this valve is replaced with a resistor in the circuit, then we can see that the resistor will increase or decrease the current in the circuit. Now you must be wondering what the resistor looks like. Everything in the circuit that changes the value of the current can be a resistor. Bulb, LEDs, or any special kind of wire can be resistor. According to Ohm's law, it can be said that the value of potential difference in circuit is equal to the product of values of the electric current and resistance of the conductor. The relation was discovered by Ohm, so the SI unit of resistance is named as Ohm and is represented by the Greek letter Ohm. If the potential difference across the two ends of a conductor is 1 volt and the current through it is 1 ampere, then the resistance R of the conductor is 1 ohm. That is, 1 ohm is equal to 1 volt upon 1 ampere. Now let's perform an activity to prove Ohm's law. To perform this activity, we need 4 1.5 volt batteries, an ammeter, a voltmeter, and a 1/2 meter long nichrome wire that will act like a resistor here, and a switch hand copper wires to connect the circuit. Nichrome is an alloy of nickel, chromium, iron, and manganese. Connect the circuit in this fashion. We know that the ammeter connected in series and voltmeter in parallel. After the circuit is complete, put on the switch and write down the readings of ammeter and voltmeter in the table. One thing to note here is that wires in the circuit also have little resistance, and also the potential difference between the terminals of the battery keeps decreasing over time. But here to explain Ohm's law, the potential difference of the battery and the reading of the voltmeter are taken equal. Do the same process 4 times and increase one battery each time in the circuit. If the ratio of potential difference and electric current is taken, they will always be the same. So we can say that the rule given by Ohm between the current and potential difference was correct. What will happen if the nichrome wire is replaced by another resistance, say an LED light? Will the ratio still be the same as it was in the case of a nichrome wire? Let's try this. Here the value of electric current has changed due to LED light. So through both these activities, we can say that the value of resistance changes when resistor gets changed. So it would be fair to say that the resistance will be constant until the resistor is replaced by another one. Besides the material and physical appearance of the resistor, resistance depends on other factors as well. We'll understand those factors in our next video. With the help of Ohm's law, we have come to know a very beautiful relation between potential difference and electric current. We got to know about the ratio of these two quantities, which is known as resistance. We have also seen what effect resistance has on the circuit. Every object has its own resistance. But the question is, what are those factors on which resistance depends majorly? In today's video, we will see which factors the resistance depends, and also we will enlighten the different ways of connecting resistance in the circuit. So come on, let's perform an activity to understand. To perform this activity, we need 3 pieces of nichrome wire having lengths of 1/2 meter, 1 meter and 2 meter. Other wire can be taken if there is no nichrome wire. One piece 1/2 meter longer and thicker than the former nichrome wire, an ammeter, a key, a 9 volt battery, and wires to connect the circuit. Connect the circuit in this way. As soon as we close the key after connecting the 1/2 meter wire in the circuit, we'll get a reading in the ammeter and write in the table. We know that the connecting wires in the circuit would also have some resistance which can cause in the drop of voltage. But to understand the theory here, the drop in the voltage is not taken into consideration. For this reason, the potential difference that the battery is producing is taken into account only. Now let's replace this with 1 meter wire. What? A change in the reading of the ammeter can be seen. Let us now apply 2 meter wire. The reading changed again. If you look carefully, you will find that by increasing the length of the wire, the value of electric current is decreasing. But the potential difference is constant. This means that the resistance in the circuit is increasing. If the value of the resistance is determined, a pattern will appear. Increasing the length of the wire also increases the resistance. Due to the increase in the length, the electric current has to flow to the larger distance, due to which more resistance is faced by it. This is the reason that the resistance has increased and the value of electric current has decreased. In the second case, we put a thick wire and will compare the reading of the ammeter with the previous case. We saw that there is an increase in the value of the ammeter. If you look closely, you will know that as the thickness of the wire is increased, the current flow has also increased and the resistance has decreased. In other words, the thicker the wire is, the more cross-sectional area the wire has. We can conclude this from the activity. 1. Resistance of wire is directly proportional to the length of the wire. 2. Resistance is inversely proportional to the cross-sectional area of the wire. 3. Also, it depends on the material of the wire, which we have already understood in our last video. It can be written in a mathematical way. If L represents the length of the wire and A is the area of the cross-section, then the resistance will be directly proportional to the length and inversely proportional to the area. A constant has to be brought to remove the sign of proportionality. Here, this constant is represented by rho. Rho is known as resistivity. The SI unit of resistivity is the ohm meter. Resistivity depends on the material of the conductor. So this is all about the resistance and the resistivity. Now let's move forward. If we see in our house, different devices are connected to the power supply. You must have noticed that when one device gets defected, then it doesn't have any effect on the other. If one bulb in our house gets fused, then the other one still glows. Or you might have seen a device like a fuse or MCB, which is located near the electric meter. The work of these devices is to minimize the risk of getting the electric appliances defected when there is a short circuit in the house. In this part of the video, we'll learn about connecting these devices in the electric circuit and understand how different resistors are connected in the circuit. You must have heard about the series and parallel many times. What do this series and parallel denote? Let us understand this closely. Let's take a circuit. If an ammeter is placed in the circuit and the switch is turned on, then we will get the value of electric current in the circuit. If one more bulb is added in series here, then the way the first bulb was glowing earlier is not glowing in that way, but both the bulbs are glowing equally lesser than the former case. Hence, the value of the electric current has also decreased, but the same current is flowing in both of the bulbs. Then why are these bulbs are glowing lower now? The reason behind the low brightness of the bulb is due to the change in second quantity of the electricity, that is potential difference. Let us use a multimeter to measure the potential difference. A multimeter is a device used to find the value of many electrical quantities. Here this multimeter will act as voltmeter. If we put the multimeter at these points, we will get 9 volt. And if we connect it with both the bulbs, the reading will look something like this. From this activity, it can be concluded the value of electric current in the series circuit is equal and the value of the potential difference is divided among the resistors based on the resistances in the circuit. The second conclusion is that if the potential difference across each resistance is added, then it will be equal to the total potential difference in the circuit. We can write this conclusion in the form of mathematical formula. And if we apply the Ohm's law here, then we get this kind of equation. We know that current is constant throughout. Lastly, we get the following equation. can be said that in series connection, if all the individual resistances are added, then we get the equivalent resistance in the circuit. In the second case, if both the bulbs are connected parallelly in the circuit, then the connection is known as parallel circuit. The parallel circuit is opposite to the series. See here, both the bulbs are glowing equally, which means that both the bulbs have an equal amount of potential difference across their ends. At the same time, the electric current appears to be divided in two arms. If you look closely, the entire electric current has increased in this case, even if the battery used is the same. So it can be concluded that the potential difference across the resistance in parallel is equal, but the current is divided in the circuit. If the number of resistance increases, then the current is also divided based on the number of resistances. Here, if we add the values of the individual currents, then we see it will be equal to the equivalent current in the circuit. Here, the equation can be written in this form by applying Ohm's law. As the potential difference is same across the circuit, we get the relation among the resistances of the parallel circuit. If the number of resistors is increased, they will continue to be added in the equation in the same fashion. This is the reason that all the electrical appliances in our house are connected in parallel, so that every appliance can get the current according to their resistance, and the malfunction of one appliance will not affect the other. Similarly, the fuses are placed in series so that all the electric current passes through it, and at the time of short circuit, no other device gets defected as it stops the electricity supply there only. So in today's video, we found out the factors on which resistance depends. Also the different ways of connecting the resistance in the circuit. Hopefully you have understood everything in this video. At the same time, you must have also understood the secret behind various appliances in the house and how they work. We will get to know about them more closely in the upcoming videos. We know that bulb brightens our room. The hot iron is used to iron our clothes, as well as the heater helps to keep our rooms warm. If you look at all these devices, one thing will be common with all. These three devices start heating up in the presence of electricity. So what causes this and how does the appliance heat? Perhaps you're thinking that there is something special in these devices due to which they get heated. Such as the filament in the bulb, the heating element in the iron, and the heating coil in the heater. But if there is something special in these devices, why does the electric fan warm up when it is touched after switching it off? Why does the fridge is hot on one side when touched? Why does the charger get hot when applied on mobile charging? Why do both sides of a television stay hot? There is not even a special heating element in them. Then what is the reason behind these cases? Maybe you are confused. In today's video, you will get the answer to your confusion. There is only one reason behind the heating of electric appliances, which we know as the heating effect of electric current. Yes, due to the flow of electric current, there is a heating effect on the appliances. The heating effect is generated due to the loss of energy in the resistance of the appliances. Some of the energy converted from electricity is used to run the equipment, and the rest of the energy flows out of the equipment in the form of heat. If you look in terms of science, work done in moving a unit charge from one point to another is called electric potential difference. So if we take the entire work, which is known as the total work done, we can represent it with W. In physics, we have also read that the work done is equal to the change in energy. Then we can say that the energy from electricity will be equal to this work, which is denoted by H. If we multiply and divide the RHS of the equation by T, we'll get this equation. And after applying the formula of voltage from Ohm's law, such an equation will be obtained. This equation is known as Joule's law of heating. The law implies that heat produced in a resistor is directly proportional to the square of current for a given resistance, directly proportional to resistance for a given current, and directly proportional to the time for which the current flows through the resistor.
If we try to understand this from the example of iron, then we will know that there is a coil in the iron which has resistance. Due to the voltage change, electric current in this coil increases and decreases, due to which heat also increases and decreases. Also, the longer the iron is on, the more it will emit heat. Besides heating effect, power also plays an important role in electricity. We'll learn about this in our next video. Have you ever bought a bulb from a hardware shop? The shopkeeper asks you which bulb you want and you say, "Give me a 100 watt bulb or a 60 watt bulb." But what does this 100 watt or 60 watt mean? Have you ever looked at electrical appliances in your home carefully? If you have ever looked at iron in your house, it has 1 kilowatt written on it. In the same way, 1.5 kilowatt on the heater as well. But what is this watt or kilowatt? This is actually the electric power of this device. Now, what is this power? Let us understand about this. The rate of doing any work is called power. For example, if you take 10 minutes to get home from school, in coming home from school, your body must have done some work. The rate of work done by the body in those 10 minutes can be shown as power. In terms of science, the work done is equal to energy. If its rate is taken, then it represents power. Like heat, power can be written in different ways. SI unit of power is watt, which is represented by W. 1 watt is equal to 1 joule of work done in 1 second. Let's go back where we started, 100 watt. 100 watt means that the bulb will consume 100 joules of energy in 1 second. Let's take another example. Your homes must have electricity meters. You must have heard that 50 units of electricity have run this time. Do you know what these 50 units are? Let us understand this. 1 unit means 1 kilowatt hour. We use kilowatt because watt is a very small unit. 1 kilowatt is equal to 1000 watt. Here watt hour is the unit of electrical energy coming to our houses. 1 watt hour is the electrical energy consumed when 1 watt power is used for 1 hour. The commercial unit of electrical energy is kilowatt hour and it is commonly known as unit. 1 kilowatt hour is equal to 3.6 into 10 to the power 6 joules. After this video, I hope you have understood the power supply of your homes better.